I'm Rachel Sloan, and this is Nicci French. We will, of course, have plenty of time for conversation, questions, and everything else, but we must thank Seaport Freight Services who have made this all happen, our sponsors today. Thank you so much for coming on a beautiful sunny day. You've had an horrendous journey, which I'm sure we'll hear all about. Lovely to have your mum here with us as well. And we're looking forward to the conversation. There might be a slight surprise for some of you that we've got two authors. Well, Nicci French, we have of course got Sean French and Nicci Gerard, who work together as Nicci French, and we're going to find out how on earth that happens today and how they don't end up arguing all the time and still happily married, yeah?
Well, I think there's fun examining assumptions in that question.
I'm sure all will become clear. Anyway, they've been writing crime novels together for 20 years while being married, working as journalists and bringing up four children. Sean and Nicci also write solo novels in their own names. They're currently writing an 8-book series with a therapist called Frieda Klein at the centre. Oh, are you hooked? Are you hooked? I am so hooked, I won't tell you. And I thought, I'm going to get to see the new one. Mine arrived in the post at 8 o'clock this morning. So I haven't. I've seen it's on the bookstall, so it is here, but it's not officially out until the 30th. So I haven't had time to read it yet, but we won't have any spoiler alerts or anything. So we'll talk about that much more today. They live in Suffolk, and we are so pleased to have them today. Thank you so much for coming along. Lovely to see you both.
Lovely to be here, even if not entirely in one piece.
Yeah, just tell us the tale of your exciting journey here today.
Well, we were yesterday celebrating Midsummer in Sweden. And it was brilliantly arranged to catch a plane. I think it went to 8 o'clock, and it was one of those. Where it's not just delayed, but delayed in a very sadistic way, where it just creeps like half an hour, and then so we finally, and we thought we might actually be cancelled altogether, but it was finally left at 2 a.m. arrived in Heathrow at sort of 4 or 3, and then we had to wait another 2 hours to get our bags. Wow. it was really, really like a war zone back there. People,
but it was worth it.
It was worth it. Here we are.
They couldn't let us down, being Suffolk authors, particularly, could they?
So. Also, something like this, every time we do that, then it's, you know, there is going to be a scene in a baggage hall in 2 a.m. It's going to turn up one of our books. It just. Summer, for example, as soon as you there, you can imagine when it was very strange. We arrived and the carousel was just going round, and there were just lots and lots of bags, but with no one collecting them. And you were just waiting for a bag and then a body to come. round, you know, that's page one.
Hang on a minute, let me just check page 272, perhaps. We'll look forward to that in a future book. So I think I'm going to kick off with the first question, if I may, because it is the big question that everyone wants to know. How can two people write such books as yours? How can you write together? How practically do you do it?
So practically, and we'll come to things like the argument later. So practically, the method that we kind of cobbled together for our very first novel, how many years ago? 20 years ago?
We started, I'm very good on pedantic dates. We started writing our first novel on the... like almost the first day of 1995.
So 21 years ago. So the method we cobbled together then for Memory Game is the one that we still use. It's the only one we know how to use, really. And that is that we actually never write together. We never write sitting in the same room as each other. So what we do is we spend weeks and months planning the book, and that means sitting at the kitchen table, drinking tea, drinking coffee, later on drinking wine, going on long walks, talking about the plot, the kind of feeling of the book, why it has to be written, the characters, the voice of the book. And then when we know we've got the same book in each other's heads, that's when we start writing. And so I write, this is rather gendered, because I write up in the attic like the mad woman, and Sean writes in a shed in the garden. And so one of us, and we never plan in advance who will start, one of us will start and write, say, a chapter, and then they will email it. This is very important. They'll email it to the other. So I, my attic, might email it to Sean, and then he will go through it, and he is free to change it, to add to it, to erase it, just to kind of make it more like Nicci French, as it were. And then he will write the next, say, chapter and email it back to me in my attic. And that's how we proceed. So we kind of stir it in between us. But the really important thing to say about that is not that I'm writing as... When we write separately, we have very different writing styles. You couldn't mistake us. So it's not that I'm writing like Nicci Gerard and sending it to Sean, who's trying to push as much Sean French into it as possible. It's not a fight between these two voices. It's like the third voice that we created. We're both trying to write into the voice of Nicci French. So it really isn't, it's not a power struggle. It's a kind of deep collaboration.
The phrase comes to mind, actually, there's a third person in this marriage.
I think apart from the question of how we write, the question of why we do it, collaborating is, anyone here has written fiction, writing fiction is hard, but writing fiction collaboratively is really hard. And I certainly say, if there's anyone here whose relationship is a bit wobbly, don't write a novel together trying to sort out your problems, because there is a kind of tension. But I mean, the reason we did it originally is, you know, when we met we were both journalists, and we were just so used to kind of reading what each other wrote and sharing what we, and also talking about what we read, so we just had the idea that it would be interesting as an experiment to see if we could write together. And I think the reason why we're still doing it all these years and decades later there is something about doing it together. And as Nicci says, it is a third voice, and also somehow we do kind of prod each other into going into areas that we wouldn't maybe do on our own. There's a French psychological term called folie à deux, which is used usually a couple who meet and commit far worse crimes together than they would ever have done on their own. You know? And I think in a way that's the way we write. We somehow write for each other in a kind of strange way.
Yeah, and it has been, you know, it's been a way of exploring the world together. So if there are things that we feel anxious about or fearful of or unsettled by, things we can't decide, it's our way of trying to find out what we think about the world we live in together. So it's been kind of very much part of our marriage, really, that way of kind of thinking through writing. And now, just one last thing about how we write together is,
we don't need any more questions, actually. We cross them all out.
We can wind them up and let them go. It's fine.
So this is probably me being overtired. I'm just going to gabble. So we have like three very, very simple rules when we write together. But actually they're rules which all relate to that thing that I was talking about it not being a power struggle. And the first is that we never sit down with each other and tell each other what we're going to do to each other's beautiful prose. So if I send something to Sean, because I love very much, and it comes back to me later, and I see it's been kind of just removed, that's been done invisibly. We can't do it. We have to kind of be very careful of each other's feelings and respect the kind of vulnerability of being a writer and changing each other's writing. And the second rule is that we're not allowed to... If I write that beautiful piece and Sean takes it out and then sends it back to me, I'm not allowed to put it back in again, because we have to assume that we're each other's best editor and reader, and that we're not doing it for kind of bad motives. And there is a third reason. Oh yeah, the third reason is that we never tell anybody at all who's written which passage. So it's
can I one tiny thing before we get to another question, which is just, one of the things I've often talked about is technology and writers, and the way you write. And I am absolutely certain that we would not have been able to collaborate before the invention of, you know, writing on the computer, simply because it would be too visible. So because both Nicci and I started journalism in the days where you actually typed it on the typewriter. And I think if I had typed something and it came back with kind of red scrawls and huge crossings out and things written out the margin, it would just be too, you'd be too sort of, make too insecure making, and somehow it all just disappears into the soup of prose as you on the word processor. Anyway,
no, sorry. That's fine. We are happy to open up to yourselves. We've got microphones that can come to you. So if you do have a question, right on the front row here, if we could. Yes, we've got a microphone coming to you now.
You say you email to each other. 20 years ago, did we have email? And if we didn't, how did you do it 20 years ago?
That raises another interesting question.
I think we must have done, because I cannot, we never, or we had memory sticks or something. We definitely have never done it so that we've kind of sat down together in front of the text and looked at it together. Because I think that really would have been impossible. I mean, the thing about writing together but writing separately is that, I mean, we once tried to, the very final chapter of our first book, we thought as a kind of symbolic act of unity and triumph that we'd actually got to the end, we would sit and write the final chapter together. And it was dreadful. We sat together and we wrote about one paragraph of kind of grey, bad prose, and we bickered, and it took the morning, and then we threw it away. And because we have to have that thing of, the kind of magic of writing where you can disappear into yourself and it takes you to places that you hadn't known you were going to be going. And an email is part of that, that sense of allowing writing to be to liberate you, to kind of find ways of expressing things that you hadn't known you were going to.
Can I answer the question in a completely irrelevant way as well, which is that it seems that, so we've been writing for 20 years, and even now that our earlier books start to seem like historical novels, in the sense that if you read them now, one of our daughters was reading them and commenting on just how it's a different age, so people don't have, it's funny when you have psychological thrillers where people don't have mobile phones and they don't have access to Google and they don't have email, and that actually all these things are wonderful for our life. They're bloody terrible for writing thrillers. And as you may have noticed, constantly in films you have to have really contorted explanations, like, damn, no battery on my mobile phone. Because of course, you can always play a game, go to any thriller you like, written in the past, and most of them would be solved in 5 minutes by someone calling for help on a mobile phone.
Well,
or
CCTV cameras, we always struggle with that. What about the CCTV? They're always breaking down in our novels.
They're the sort of things we're going to look out for when we read them in the future. And as I said, do put your hand up if you have an extra question to ask. Otherwise, I'll just keep going. And this is very much your conversation as well as mine. So I'll keep my eyes open. So who writes that all important first paragraph and that even more important final paragraph?
Well, first of all, we're not going to tell you.
Oh, yes, of course. You said earlier, didn't you?
Because that is one of our rules. Is that, I mean, and that rule actually is very important, because we need to think, we both of us own every single comma in the book, just by the act of approving it, we own it. So we're not going to tell you that. But also, we never decide in advance who's going to write which bit. And we edit each other and then re-edit each other. And so there is a way in which, by the end, sometimes we almost can't tell anyway. It's just not the point. The point is that it's Nicci French who's written the first paragraph and the last paragraph. And it sounds a bit pretentious to talk about Nicci French, as if she's something, but it really is. It's Nicci French. So if I started saying I wrote that bit, or if you said to me, oh, I didn't like that paragraph, and I said, oh, don't worry, that was Sean. We couldn't write together, and we probably, our marriage would have collapsed as well.
Can you say one more point as well? I think some people think, well, it must be kind of efficient to have two people. So one person, maybe one of you is better at writing action scenes, and one of you is good at the emotional things. For example, there was some people may know the Swedish thriller writers who were a married couple called Sjöwall and Wallin, who wrote in the 60s and 70s, and they had a real division of labour. I think he wrote the police procedural stuff, and she wrote the kind of more literary things. we have no division of labour at all, so we never decide in advance who will write. You know, oh, so-and-so is, but you, you know, you're always good at that kind of scene. And also, when we do research, we don't say, I'll do that research, you do this. We all have to own every bit of the book. We all have to find out about everything. So, I mean, it's actually, in terms of writing a book, it's much slower than one person researching and writing a book because of it, just handing it back. So,
psychological thrillers. I mean, you have some very scary people in them, and they're very addictive. But I mean, do you have nightmares?
Well, we do.
We do have nightmares, but maybe we don't have nightmares because we write psychological thrillers. Maybe we write psychological thrillers as a way of thinking about nightmares. I mean, I think that, you know, the kind of thrillers that are written now are very, very kind of rich and fruitful way of trying to think about and confront the things that most scare us. And writing about things isn't scary. It's actually writing about things gives a kind of shape and a kind of narrative to the chaos of terror, I think.
Also, I think one of the things that we've really felt in the books we write is we're not sort of so much drawn to kind of the, you know, 10 slaughtered bodies found hanging in a barn or something. It's we almost like to start from the point of view of things not being a thriller. People who, I mean, so sometimes, and this is, you know, that's fine, but in some thrillers, you almost feel from the beginning, all the characters seem to already know they're in a thriller, even though nothing has happened yet to show it. You know? And in a way, what's interesting is, because the small experience we've had of a kind of thrillerish things happening, you know, if you witness a crime or an accident, what's kind of interesting about it is that weird transition from everything being normal to you suddenly having to realise things have really changed and what are you going to do about it? That's one of the things we're constantly interested in, is how normal people suddenly realise, you know, they've made one wrong choice or they've taken a few wrong steps and things have suddenly become terrifying. And in a way, that's more frightening, I think.
Yeah, and I think that's the kind of heart of every single Nicci French novel, is that, you know, the one thing that Sean and I, one of the many things that Sean and I share in common, is that belief that you know, people go around thinking they're in control of their own world. So, you know, they might have a job or a house or a marriage or children, they feel that they've been responsible for being in control, they deserve it. And what we think is that actually we're all on very thin ice, and it just takes one little thing and you go through and you're in this whole new world, which is both the world of dread and also it's the world of the self, the things that you discover about the self when you fall through that thin ice.
Because the traditional question is where you get your ideas from, and one answer is, we really feel that anyone who's lived in a family or knows a family, you've got a lifetime of material for psychological thrillers.
I haven't read the family in a while, but the hand went up at the back, the lady with the dark t-shirt. I don't know if we could get a microphone to her. You could raise your hand clearly, it's coming. We're using the microphones because of the loop system, of course. Thank you.
So picking up on what you just said about plot, where do the majority of your plot lines come apart from baggage halls in the early hours of the morning? So are they largely drawn from personal experience? Or things you've read, for example?
I mean, So what did you say, for example?
The baggage hall.
Or things you've read, for example.
Oh, well, so ideas, that's so interesting. So different novels, I mean, some of our novels have started with the ending, and some have started with thinking about a scene, like the baggage hall scene, or a scene in one of the books that we wrote called Land, the Living, about someone just waking up and not knowing where or who they were, kind of almost starting from blank and darkness. Where they don't come from, really, is just, they don't come from other crime novels, because other people have done that. And they don't really come from kind of crime stories. They come much more left field than that. So I'll give one example, and then I'm sure Sean can give another. So, for our third book, which is called Killing Me Softly, we were actually writing a completely different novel. And we were about halfway through and it was going okay. And then we were in a car, traveling to see my mother in hospital, my mother who's here today. And we started talking about two things. We started talking about how we met. And when we met, We knew very little about each other, and yet we entrusted our lives to each other extremely quickly, and I had two tiny children. So we were strangers to each other, and yet in this kind of madness, and then we were thinking about how kind of falling in love is like going mad, and how most people at the heart of their lives, there's this vortex of kind of passionate madness that you build your life around. And then we thought, well, what happens when you meet somebody you trust your life, somebody goes wrong? And then we thought, that's what we want to be writing about, not this novel that we're writing at the moment, which is kind of okay, but doesn't fire us up. That turned into a novel about a kind of sexual obsession that went horribly wrong.
Yeah, I was just thinking of a letter that Philip Larkin once wrote, where he said he couldn't imagine what it was like not to be a writer. And by what he meant by that is, what do people do when something happens to you and you can't go back and write about it? Now that's like a psychological illness in a way, because you know, experience isn't experience enough in itself. But I think there is something about, I think, writers, and certainly Nicci and I have it, it's almost like you have a little valve at the front of your brain that every single thing you experience has to go through this little valve, which is a bit of, which just says, can you use that? Could that be? And so one of the things where our ideas from, I mean, there's no, Nicci and I have a sort of marriage with no barriers or hiding places, in the sense that we're just always working, in a sense. And so we just constantly talk about things. And is there a way, wouldn't that, if we just met someone and you say, God, you know, they would, you know, they'd be the right person to be murdered. Normally it's like you might, in terms of character, you might just take a certain, an irresistible aspect of someone you've just met or to come across, you know. I can think of this twice in our career have we actually put someone directly into the book, one of which is in our book Losing You, our dog is just entirely put with her name changed just to protect her. she's incredibly sensitive, actually. There is one person who we met with such an interesting character, and I'm going to have to be very vague because he or she is actually horribly killed. And so, but as far as I know, the person didn't recognise him. I tried to disguise the sex.
You already
undisguised
the sex.
I bet all your fat friends, though, open every book, you know, it's first come out, see if they're in it.
Well, in a way, that's right. One of the reasons why friends and family, they're kind of the best readers, but also the worst readers, because they're always trying to find kind of autobiography. And I think, you know, in a way, you can say that every fiction is autobiographical, but it's autobiographical in a strange, translated way. So things kind of get transformed and mixed together.
Okay.
Sean says you're like kind of cannibal or a vulture, just picking little bits from everywhere and sticking them together.
Well, it's actually another, this is not an example of a character, but to go back to the book Losing You, which is about a teenage girl going missing, and one of the things that the narrator has to do to kind of find the girl is she always has to break taboo after taboo to find out about her teenage daughter's life, things she shouldn't know. And one of the things she does is to break into her room and go through this teenage girl's bedroom. And when we were writing that particular bit, we didn't break into our daughter's bedroom, but we did go into our daughter's bedroom while she was at school and just describe everything that was in it. Because in a way, you just take this.
We just wrote a whole list of all the mess.
That's why it seems so real. Right. So, I mean, you've got four children, grown up now, but does it mean you've been a little bit paranoid about their health and safety and worried about them being abducted?
No, actually, not at all. I mean, I think. Parents have different ways of worrying about that. I mean, I worry about my children. I worry about them not doing things. I want them to take risks.
I think one of the things is, if you do, and one thing we do just as part of over 20 years, we do lots and lots of, I mean, research is one thing, you research specific things, but also very kind of wide reading and all the things that are relevant to it. And one of the things, if you do research about crime, you really realise basically how safe you are, you know. And actually, most children, for example, most small children, they're safer telling them to go off and play with strangers. It's their own family are the ones who are likely to damage it. So, I mean, actually, we live in one of the safest, living in southern England, is, you know, there are very few places in the history of humanity have been the same.
On the other hand, what we have done definitely as parents, we've taken those kind of parental feelings of kind of protectiveness and tenderness, and we've turned them into thrillers. You know, we've written about the child who died, we've written about children who go missing. So we certainly have used our own emotions as well as everybody else's.
And of course, one of the fascinating, I think, one of the things about, you know, the whole thing about why are thrillers interesting? Why are there things that people want to write and people want to read? Because one is, it's always to do that because we're not living in somewhere like the Congo, where there's where you're likely to be killed in civil war, and yet we're still, you know, people are still anxious, we're still afraid, and that's why. So, in a way, I think the psychological thriller is a really good, and it, just in the way that one reads the kind of fairy tales we read to small children, which are actually bloody terrifying, you know, we look at what happens in them. But it's a way of children to kind of develop their imagination and learn about the world. And I think that the thriller is a really useful, kind of almost therapeutic way, I think, of exploring
that. Yeah, and I think especially now, I think there's a way in which thrillers, you know, if we live in a world where kind of our belief in kind of absolutes has gone, so we, you know, we don't believe that kind of God or the priest or the doctor or the therapist or anyone is going to save us. What we now, you know, I think our book's always doing is that, you know, we have to save ourselves. And the thrillers that we write and the thrillers that lots of other people write are about kind of how you save yourself. So how you save yourself literally out there in the world of crime, and just how you save yourself, how you take responsibility for yourself in a kind of secular age of uncertainty and dread.
Mm. You mentioned procedural accuracies earlier. I mean, how carefully do they have to be researched?
So we don't write procedural books, so we don't write about the world of the police, and that's very, you know, we always said that we didn't want to write about a variety of police procedurals. I mean, other people do that wonderfully, and that's not really what we're interested in doing. And so what we need to make sure is that we get it right, and we need to make sure that we get it right and we get it detailed, so that we don't just talk about kind of vaguely about kind of tools and kind of clues. We actually kind of do the research. We do enough research so that if you're in the world of Nicci French, it's a world that feels authentic and vivid. So we need to know that if a body is found after 25 years, what it will look like and what the soil around it will look like. We need to know what kind of ranks people have. We need to know about DNA testing. But you only need to know as much as you need to know. And sometimes you don't even need to know the truth. You need to know enough to create an imaginary world that everyone feels they can trust. A bit like, you know, it's not just about the procedural details, all details. Kind of, you know, the devil is in the detail. We need to know what somebody's fridge is like if you open it, or what things are underneath someone's bed, or what it's like up a mountain in freezing weather.
So do you have a team of people that you can call up and ask, or is it good old Google?
It sounds very grand, but yeah, if you have a whole team of servants that are always being dispatched. No, some writers do actually use researchers, and that would be, it's not disastrous, it would be such a mistake, because I mean, one of the things that's fascinating about research, and or even about, you know, and research is a very different kind. Research can be about, you know, procedures or objects, or it can be about places. And one of the fascinating things about research, when you do it yourself and do it properly, or you say you talk to people, or you go to the place, or you read the manual or whatever, you often find out not the thing you expected to find out, and that, you know, so if you sent a kind of, you know, an intern to do it, you know, that wouldn't be right, because it's often the thing on the other side of the page, the thing you weren't actually looking at, that thinks, God, now that would really work interestingly. And so I think so research is really important. I mean, I think I'm sure people agree with. I think one of the key things about thrillers is not just having, you know, a clever plot or something like that, is you need to believe that world, you know, and every book, and I think it applies to every kind of book and film, is it can be any kind of genre, but it has to obey the rules of that it's created for its own world, and it can be very weird and whatever, but you have to believe in that world and people. Otherwise, if you think that people are just making it up as they go along, you just withdraw and then...
So in fact, one of the big bits of research that we now do in this series is London is the landscape of London, the world of London, and that thing of immersing yourself in those stranger parts of London, the kind of secret histories, the kind of forgotten, kind of odd, uncanny parts of London that are changing all the time. So we spend days kind of walking around London and cycling around London and just immersing ourselves. Because actually, you know, with thrillers, I think, you know, often the landscape is just crucial. That kind of that where it's set, what it feels like, what the weather's like, what the kind of ground underfoot is like.
We'll come back to landscapes perhaps a little bit later on, but you've mentioned the series, and that is such a clever marketing idea. I mean, I read it on Monday, and I was hooked. And now it's been Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. We're now up to Saturday. This morning on Facebook, I put on that I was going to be talking to you and took a photo of the cover of the latest book, and someone immediately came back to me and said, brilliant, I've been waiting for that. Can you ask them if, or they said, I wonder if they're working on Sunday already, and I said I would ask you.
Okay.
So are you working on Sunday already?
We're editing Sunday at the moment, so Sunday is finished, and there are 7 days in most people's week.
Yes.
In readers, there are 8 days, so it's an 8-day week. And you say marketing idea. Actually, it wasn't actually a marketing idea. It was an idea about, you know, we wanted to write about somebody living through a good slab of time, like about a decade, which is significant in someone's life, to see how they change and how experience marked them. And so the kind of idea of calling them after the days of the week, 8 days a week, was about time passing, about that sense just of kind of time passing and the week drawing to a close and experiences accumulating.
Can I say also, you say it's a really good idea. We've talked about this together, looking back, and we think it's a really terrible idea, actually, because Nicci can talk about the character of freedom maybe in a minute, but we started from the character of freedom. We thought, this is not going to be one book. We're going to do it in a series. And so we kind of said in advance, we're going to write 8 books.
And fortunately,
it worked. But if it had just ground to a halt on Tuesday, this everyone got tired of this character.
We had a very, very long weekend.
I have to say, there are a few occasions in literary history where people have grandly announced that they're embarking on a 14-book sequence, and it's sort of after 2 books, you know, so nothing more was heard.
Yeah, and the days of the week, so,
exactly, I know. In a way, partly, I think there was something, because up to that point, we'd very much, each book had been a standalone thriller. And in fact, it wasn't exactly the inspiration, but it's certainly one of the things that's coagulated, if to use a horrible term for inspiration. Someone wrote a favourable review of one of our books and said, the good thing about Nicci French is she's never written a series. You know, long may it continue. There is a way in which as soon as someone says,
Does that interest who's reading the series of books of the Monday to Monday? Yes, quite a lot of us. And the others are now going to be.
I
was confident, don't worry at all. I've got this paper copy, the others I've read on this. Has that made a big change to you, the e-readers?
As readers or writers? Because it's made a bit of an improvement to our marriage, because one of the terrible, because Nicci's very disciplined. Nicci reads one book at a time, and I read in this chronic sort of attention disorder. I read about 12 books at a time.
No, he
took a whole bookshelf by the side. So going on holiday was sort of like, you know, about 9/10 of the way each book. So for holidays, I think Kindles are wonderful. They're really great. I think, but they've almost made you think again about what a wonderful object a book is, I think, because I think there's something about it doesn't. There are things about you don't quite think feel you're reading a book.
Heft of a book and the sand in the pages, and also with Kindle, when you get to 3%, that doesn't feel very satisfying.
You mentioned Frieda, of course, let's talk about her, this amazing character. Authors always say they feel they know their character. You must know her inside out.
That's interesting, because I don't think we do know her inside out. And one of the reasons that we decided, Sean was talking about this journalist who said long may, you know, we were kind of triggered by this journalist. What we were really triggered by was the character of Frida, who almost kind of came to visit us. She came to us, we were talking about our next book, and we thought about a psychotherapist who doesn't believe that you can solve the mess and the awfulness of the outside world. What she believes in is confronting the kind of mess and vulnerability of the self in the consulting room. So she doesn't want to be a detective, but she's kind of dragged into the world and discovers she has a gift for it. So we thought of this woman who was quite reclusive and solitary and prickly and difficult and honourable and a truth teller and very good at discovering other people's secrets and very good at guarding her own secrets. And once we thought of that, we thought, she just won't disclose herself to us in a single book. We cannot tell her, get to the end of her story in a single book. So it's actually from that realization that Frida kind of wouldn't let us discover things about her just in one book. So we do, I mean, I think we know her, you know, she's part of our marriage. We go around saying, oh, what would Frida do? And what would Frida think? And Frida wouldn't like that. So we have lists of things that Frida loves and Frida hates. She hates much more than she loves. So we know her in that sense, but actually in the act of writing is also displayed. And that's kind of rather the wonderful thing about writing. You know, we thought, you know, we often think that she's going to do one thing and then she turns out to do another thing. She won't quite obey us. So she's gradually letting us discover her and we're finding more out about her. But nothing, you know, we've still got another book to go.
Well, it makes me think about, you know, the issue of when, if you like a writer, do you want to meet them? And I've always been a bit hesitant about meeting writers I admire, because it'd be so awful if they were really horrible to you. And I'd be rather worried about meeting Frida. She might be really mean to me.
She's not mean, but she sees through people. And I think that one of the reasons that people like Frida is because she recognises people like Frida, but also she might be terrifying, is because she recognises the self that you often try and hide, you know, the kind of self that you kind of don't want to show the world. So you have all these defences, and Frida disregards defences, she sees through them.
She's such a central character. How important are the characters around Carson, for example?
Well, I mean, one of the pleasures of writing the series was completely new to us, was because before everything just got rounded off and the story came to an end. And in a way, gradually through the books, Frida, she's a loner who kind of keeps attracting people and builds up a group around her. And it's been a really interesting challenge to see with bringing in these other characters who kind of progress and interact. And I mean, an example that's almost easier to talk about. There's this Ukrainian builder, Joseph, who appears in the first book. And he, when we wrote that, he was really intended. He fulfilled a very particular function in that story. And the idea was that's all we thought about. And that was a character who, we found with these characters, it's a bit like inviting people to a party. And sometimes they just don't get on, and sometimes they do. So, and what you find is some characters, like Joseph, just wouldn't leave the party, you know, just because he became too functional and he fitted in too well for us, you know, became kind of useful. And so that's been the kind of thing. And to be able to sort of, and also, in a way, of course, by the time, normally with the books we've done before, by the time people say, oh, I didn't like that character, well, it's too late. The book's published and we can't go back and remove them. But what's interesting is you're not entirely guided by it. It's not saying, oh, I want so-and-so to get together or something. But it's more like, it's just interesting seeing characters, because books and characters somehow change once people read them, when you meet readers and people talk about them. So that's been a very new way of
writing. Yeah, no, what Sean's saying is right, that quite often you do not know what you're going to do with a character. It just kind of, you know, you don't quite know how they're all going to get on with it. I mean, Joseph is a very good example. In fact, there's an example of autobiography, because Joseph enters Monday by falling through a ceiling into Frida's consulting room. And that actually happened to us like 25 years ago. We were sitting having lunch and this builder was upstairs and he just fell through the ceiling and just landed on the floor and thought he's dead. And then he just got up and dusted himself off and went away. And we kept that scene in our heads. We were waiting and we needed to use it for Joseph, because Joseph literally crashes into Frida's life and he will not go away. And he becomes like her almost like her protector and her knight, and he's like the kind of fool in Shakespeare's plays. And so we kind of suddenly realised that we'd made a character that all the other characters in the book needed to have in their lives. And the other thing I'd add as well is that, you know, when we start in Monday, Frieda is in her mid-30s, so by the end of the series, she'll be in her mid to late 40s.
If she's still alive.
So spoiler alert. So that's a very... That's
you don't want people to relax too much.
It's a very significant decade in, you know, in the life of a woman, especially in the life of a childless woman. She's child, you know. And then we've got all these others, so like her niece is a teenager, kind of stroppy teenager, and then by the end, if she's still alive, she'll be in her mid-20s. And then so all these people are going through kind of stages of life. And that's just been, and being hurt and bashed about by life and are changing. I mean, that's what's really wonderful is letting, you know, often we think of the self as being very coherent, as if you've got one self and that it's fixed. But actually, of course, we're a muddle of selves. And that's what's been so good about writing a series, is that we can allow people to change and be contradictory and to behave badly and to be rescued.
I bet I'm not the only person sitting here thinking, by book 8, will Joseph have had to leave the country?
Dangerous territory here.
I just had to say it.
That's going to be uncontentious here, but we were very clear writing the book that we're writing it in real time. So in the sense that each book is set in the period when we're writing it. And so, for example, the city, London as a city, it feels like a very different place. And in fact, to take one concrete example, that Tuesday begins in this amazing area. That was a Deptford we just discovered, just cycling around, and came across this extraordinary kind of weird, deprived area, right next to Greenwich, right by the river. And then we went back 2 years later, and it's almost all gone, and beautiful flats on the, you know, all, so, I mean, so London is, you know, endlessly changing, being knocked down, ruined, rebuilt, you know. And so, I mean, we would like to be able to respond to change.
Might have given them an idea. I just have this image of you in your shed and you in your attic with this huge, great piece of paper on the wall with lots of arrows and names, a bit like a police room, you know. I mean, is the whole 8 books planned before you even start the actual structure?
So that's interesting. So we were very clear that each book has got to be standalone thriller. So if you pick up Thursday having read nothing, it should have its own proper satisfaction as a thriller. On the other hand, there's something that happens in Monday, which some of you, if you've read it, will know about, which is like, it's like it lights a fuse, if you like, and it burns its way through to the final 8th book. And that arc, that overall, an overarching story, that we know about. But we couldn't know about each book. We plan what happened book by book. We didn't know in advance because you can't. Because if you need, you know, you have to let the books kind of discover themselves. You know, the whole one of the extraordinary and wonderful things about writing, and slightly scary sometimes, is that you don't quite know what you're doing until you're doing it, and it takes you in places you hadn't known you were going to go to. And also, as Sean says, you need to respond. You need to respond to what's happening out in the world. And the book is kind of, a lot of our books, a lot of the Frieda books particularly, which are all set in London, apart from one, they're about people who kind of dropped through the net, people who've been lost and forgotten about, and people we don't want to look at, and things we don't want to see. And we're kind of fed by what's happening in the world, in our world.
I am keeping my eye open across the audience, so I haven't forgotten you, I'm just watching. Right, to here, can we have a microphone to this over here, thank you. You had to be a bit more assertive, put your hand up and then I'll know to come to you. Thank you, gentlemen there and then over there.
Having had time at the airport and time at baggage collection, was there any experience with the Swedish midsummer that you brought away with you?
Sean's got to answer that, because Sean is half Swedish, so, which is why we were there.
We, weirdly, our very first book, We Are a Good Memory Game, features, I think it begins with people going off and picking mushrooms. It's weird, it was a weird coincidence, some of it both I did in Sweden and Nicci did in Worcestershire, Shropshire. As a, do you know, it would be very tempting to write a book set in Sweden, but it would really risk the charge of opportunism in a sense of, you know, who do you think you are trying to muscle in on this kind of Sweden, Scandi, because I'm half my mother Swedish, so I could, I'm really half a Swedish crime writer, but I just never get the credit that Steve asked me.
Sorry, I'm
this side
as well, thank you.
Well, we love reading your books. I wonder if you have time to read books for pleasure yourself, and which authors in the past have given you inspiration?
Can I say that reading and writing for us go so much together. I mean, we're really, really passionate readers. We just read and read and read all the time. So we've been, you know, quite a lot of, when we were thinking of writing together and thinking that if we were going to write together, it would sort of need to be a thriller, because it needed to be something that had a kind of strong narrative structure, because if we were both going to write into that. And so one of the things, it did come out of conversations about either thrillers that really worked, or ones that didn't work for interesting reasons. I can't name exactly ones that, I'm not going to name, be rude about ones that didn't work, but the kind of thing we talked about were things like that it's really easy to set up an incredibly compelling mystery if you're not bothered how you're going to solve it. You know, I think there was one, I won't give a name on that, because I can't remember the title of it. It's a film, it's a Jodie Foster film, it's called Flight Plan or something. It's set on a plane and her child goes missing on a plane. Now that sounds really great, that's an amazing idea, but apparently the solution to it is so preposterous and ridiculous that actually everyone who said it, people think, oh God, that sounds great, but then at the end people think, is that it? Well, that's ridiculous. And I think there's that feeling of what you want is something compelling at the beginning, and then at the end you should feel, I didn't see that coming, that was a bit better than I expected. And I did put one example which
Because when we talked about thrillers, we talked, I don't know how many people have read Presumed Innocent.
By Scott Turek.
It is terrific. And it's terrific because it's terrific all the way through, and the ending is like a punch in the stomach. It is just terrific. And it was like a model of how you have to deliver the goods at the end. And then the other example, so I've stolen that from you.
Yes.
but also the other thing I say, it was one of the big, for both of us, writers like Wilkie Collins, who wrote thrillers in the past, which are, you know, the plot, it's not really the plot, it's they're so uncanny. And so there's a kind of way in which you need the plot to be extremely gripping, but also that kind of sense of a kind of uncanny world, and almost like a kind of fairy tale world, as well as being a real world, that was very important.
And can I say also, we read crime fiction, and also we don't just, I mean, weirdly, the crime fiction you're almost least likely to read are the ones that are most in our area, because in a way they're least useful for you. You can't, you know, take someone of a kind of psychological thriller with a female narrator and say, that story seems good, and we can use that one. But we very different kinds of thrillers, and in fact, I think Nicci and I have quite different tastes in thrillers, weirdly enough. Other kinds of fiction, and lots of non-fiction as well, sometimes for research, but often you find the best ideas, often things that, I mean, we don't entirely read just as a, like vampires and hope of getting something we can use. So, you know, we're very...
A nice romantic comedy, just the sort of...
But actually everything. I mean, I would say that we're really kind of omnivorous like that. So we read lots of novels, both kind of novels from the past and contemporary novels. And Sean reads loads of kind of philosophy and history and biography. You just need to read. There are some authors that I know who, when they're writing a novel, they don't read fiction because they don't want to be influenced. They want to kind of have their own voice. And I don't understand that, because in a sense, we're always being influenced all the time, so you might as well just be influenced by lots of people.
I want to ask you about that, because we talked a lot about the characters in your book, and you mentioned London and the importance of the landscape of London with the Fred Clinton series. What is the importance of landscape to you when you're writing the books?
Well, one of the things, you know, if you were going to say what, you know, if you take the genre of the thriller or the psychological thriller, you know, what people usually think of, they might think of, you might think of a kind of sort of crime at the centre and a mystery at the centre, and very often it's an important, the central character is important. I really come to think more and more that it's the setting is almost the most important thing. You know, when you think, if you go back to the wonderful Sherlock Holmes stories, but actually there's actual stories are incredibly perfunctory and often turn out not to be crimes at all. What people think of when they think of Sherlock Holmes is this London fog and the Baker Street's place they live, and you know, which is around. And I think that applies. And when I could go through in my head all the thrillers I like, I could always say, yeah, they're written in this particular setting. This bit of Boston, or this bit kind of that shows me this side of Edinburgh, and which is a long way around saying that landscape is absolutely crucial. And so we know a very big great part of our preparation for a book is going to where the place is going to be set. So, for example, we set two books in this area. One before we moved here, three in fact, or three. And we spent a lot. You need to smell it. Go on the ground. You know. I mean, in fact, the obvious example is Losing You, which is set on a very thinly disguised version of Mercy Island, where. Actually, the plot arose out of, I'm sure people know it here, but it's a kind of strange place, this place that's sort of an island, but not quite an island, that's cut off from the mainland twice a day, and it's just, it feels, and it's sort of English, but it feels sort of somehow it's out in the sea, and the story, somehow, we'd had a story floating around for years, and as soon as we went to that spot, we thought, that's how we can tell the story.
And it became part of the plot, actually. So the way that when the tide rises, this spit of land becomes an island and becomes cut off. And the way, you know, the mud flats and the shingle and the bird, it became part of what made Losing You kind of grip us as a novel and what made us want to write it.
And has a location actually been the inspiration for a story?
But I think in Losing You, the location was the... We had this idea of writing it for years. We thought we would want to write about a child going missing, every parent's worst nightmare. But that's not enough of an idea for a novel. And we couldn't work out how to do it until we were in Mersey Island and the island was getting cut off, the tide was rising. The day was closing in, so darkness was coming, and we thought that's how to do it. We'll set it in a single take, as it were, so it takes the same amount of time to read as it takes as the action takes. It's the darkest day of the year, so the light is kind of failing. The tide is rising, so the island is getting cut off, and it's written in one single chapter with not a second missing. And it was that idea of kind of isolation and kind of uncanniness that made us think that's how that book came to be written.
I could give another example, which is that Nicci and I we're very passionate walkers, which we combine with another quality we have is we're very, very bad map readers. And so we've got a long history of walking. You know, when you read about people being trapped up a mountain and the mountain rescue people say, these people should never be on the mountain. You know, they're a danger to themselves and to others. There's people like us that they have in mind. And so I remember when one of the first times we went walking, we were actually carrying one of our children, who was a baby, so it was even more irresponsible. And the mist came down and it was absolutely terrifying. And you suddenly realise and we have this very vivid sense of what it's like. You know, when you lose your bearings and it becomes difficult to make plans and you stop thinking clearly. And actually that became, you know, that was again, Nicci mentioned Killing Me Softly. That begins, I mean, actually on a mountain in the Himalayas, actually. So not, it's a bit grander than our walking in the Lake District. But you know, you don't have to tell the truth always as a writer. And it was more that feeling of when your bearings go, when you suddenly don't feel safe. So, you know, so I think over and over again, that's happened to us.
Time for a last question from the floor, if we have it. Yes, thank you very much. Microphone coming.
Thank you. I've just read one of your books, Nicci, in the Twilight Hour, and I'm just wondering whether it's easier for both of you to write an individual novel in terms of time-consuming, in terms of ideas, than writing together. I mean, do you find you get so carried away you don't want to stop?
That's such a good question, because of course we both have written separately and we write together. It is really a different experience. I mean, what's not different about it is the actual act of writing. Because what I was saying much earlier on in this hour is that in the actual act of writing together, we write alone and we kind of sink down into the self and we let the writing carry us. But when we're writing together, there's also this curious thought that we're writing for ourselves and we're also writing for each other and to each other. So there's a kind of strange double intimacy about writing together, which you can't get writing your own. So it's strange, it's both profoundly private, and yet it's got this kind of intimate collaboration. One of the real joys of writing together is ideas, is bouncing ideas off each other, having ideas, being able to share them, seeing if they work. And speaking for myself, it's really much harder to kind of know if your idea is a good idea and if it has traction or run. And the other thing about writing, when you write on your own, is that you're just on your own, so you can't hide behind each other. You know, we can both hide behind Nicci French. There's something very scary sometimes about being a writer. You feel very kind of extended, that moment of going from private to public. It feels terribly exposed and anxious making. But actually we can go around together and we can kind of hide behind each other and we can do, you know, it's been rather companionable. Like, you know, writers we're very unsolitary, solitary writers most of the time.
I think sort of the collaboration seems, if you think it seems strange to other people, I think it seems really pretty weird to us. I mean, I don't think if I'd been, you know, say 25 years ago, if someone had told me I'd been sitting in Felixstowe as a female crime writer, I'd have been most surprised as to how this would come about. I think people think, especially, you know, people say, oh, it must be such, you know, you must be compromising all the time, it must be difficult and a struggle. And I think Nicci, as just to repeat really what Nicci said, it's the opposite. There is a way in which I think writing, or say personally, you know, writing under this other name, writing as a female author, there's a kind of weird freeing, something freeing about it, like, you know, it's like people wearing a mask at a carnival or something. And so I think I think just looking at our experience, I mean, I think one of the reasons why we're still doing it, why we found it so challenging year after year, is that kind of really strange freedom.
I'm just going to add one last thing. I know you're showing up. So there's a way in which, you know, when we talk, one of the very first discussions that we have about a book is to see if it's a Nicci French idea. And there are most ideas, you know, we both need to love an idea entirely for us to write it together. So there are lots of ideas that I might, you know, that might be a Sean French idea or a Nicci Gerard idea. So there's something rather wonderful about being able to have all these different kind of selves you can inhabit. So there are only certain books that can be Nicci French books.
Well, we're really glad you came to Felixstowe and we're a female for the day. Thank you very much indeed. They are obviously going to be through at the book. Canter, is that all right?
Yeah,
indeed. So can I say a huge thank you to us all from Sean French and Nicci Gerard. Better known, you say that again. Sean French and Nicci Gerard, better known as Nicci French.